I left school in 1950 and I played in the first televised game at Wembley, England versus Scotland Schoolboys, and had a pretty good game. Got a bit of publicity, and Arsenal and Tottenham were both interested in signing me. And Arthur Rowe, as manager of Tottenham, came round to my house and had a chat, and Tom Whittaker invited me to the marble halls of Highbury, and I went there and saw him. And but they both looked, you know, too big. The clubs looked too big. They had good teams, and wasn't all that. I mean, although I was only 15, I was looking to, you know, force my way into a first team fairly quickly, and didn't seem to be too much chance of me doing that at both of these places. And my good mate Tosh Chamberlain had gone to Fulham the year before, and I decided to follow him to Craven Cottage, and that's how I come to sign for Fulham as an amateur in 1950, then as a 2 years later as a professional when I was old enough. Manager at the time at Fulham was, they had two managers, one general manager and one team manager. Frank Osborne was the general manager, and Bill Dodgins Senior was the manager of the team. So they were my first people in management. And I played for the reserves for probably for the first 3 or 4 months of the season. And Bobby Brennan, who was an Irish international, he was the inside left at the time. He got injured over the Christmas period of 1952. And I was selected to play my first game in the first team against Southampton at Craven Cottage on Boxing Day 1952. My heroes as a boy. Being an Arsenal supporter as a kid, and being a sort of what they called a scheming inside forward at the time, the guy that did that for Arsenal was one of my heroes, little Jimmy Logie, who was a very good player. And I always used to, when I went there as a youngster, I always used to watch him more than anybody, because, you know, it affected my game, and I did quite a few of the things eventually that he used to do, and there are others, of course. Tom Finney was always a hero of mine, but I suppose you could say Jimmy Logie was the one that I based my game on, really. In 1961 as well, I went, went on tour, not in 61, in 59 I went on tour to North and South America with the England team. Played against Brazil in the Maracana Stadium in front of 175,000 people. Got beat 2-1, but it was a great game, and we thoroughly enjoyed it, and we had a marvellous trip. We finished up on our way back playing against a USA side on a baseball ground in Los Angeles. In the first half we didn't play too well. I think the reason for that was that we were playing into the diamond, and the second half we were playing into the green part of the ground, and we finished up winning 8-2 after just being 1-0 up at half-time. But that was also a memorable trip, which I thoroughly enjoyed. As I say, on that trip we played against the Brazilians, and they'd obviously won the World Cup in 58, and they had great names in their side. Pelé was playing against us, and all their other stars. And it was tremendous to be on the same sort of field and playing against them. The Fulham team of that time, when we got back into the First Division, was, I think, a very good side. We had Tony Macedo in goal from Gibraltar, who was excellent goalkeeper and played many great games for Fulham. Georgie Cohen, Alan Mullery, Jimmy Langley, Roy Bentley, Eddie Lowgram, you know, all the names. Jimmy Hill, Maurice Cook, manager Betty Gerzard eventually. He was a very good player too. Tos Chamberlain. You know, we had a very good team at that time, and we did well in the First Division, because to finish sixth, because we never spent any money on transfers at all. They were all sort of main, apart from Graham Leggett and Roy Bentley, one we bought from Aberdeen, and Roy Bentley we bought from Chelsea. These were one of the few players that we bought from anywhere, I think. And we were more a selling club than a buying club. And I think that particular Fulham team was excellent side. We got to the semi-final of the FA Cup in 1958 and again in 62. In 58 we're still a second division side, so that created quite a stir. Unfortunately, we were drawn against Manchester United in the semi-final, and that was just after the Munich air crash, so that wasn't the draw that we were looking for. But anyway, we were pretty pleased with ourselves, even reaching the semi-final. And that, I think, would be as good a Fulham team as I played in the 20 years I was there. 1961, the maximum wage was lifted, and my wages went from £20 a week to £100 a week straight away, simply because Tommy Trinder had opened his mouth and said that if the maximum wage was lifted, he would put me on £100 a week straight away. And of course it was lifted, and he had to stand by his word, which he did do, to give him credit, and that also caused a bit of a sensation at the time, but it's small peanuts compared to today, I think.
What about the rest of the team? Did they all come knocking for their...
Well, yeah, they obviously were in for rises, but they didn't get £100. They probably doubled their money. They probably got 40, 50 maybe, some of them. But they certainly didn't get 100, because Tommy was in print as saying that he'd do that, and that's how it all came about. So I was known as the first £100 a week footballer, which has stuck with me ever since.
Did that give you any added pressures?
It did a bit, yeah, because obviously you're expected to, you know, £100, well, in those days, £100 a week was a lot of money. And you're expected to produce the goods week in, week out, which obviously sometimes you can't do. But it wasn't that big a bugbear. I mean, my bank manager was pleased anyway.
What about off the pitch? Did it suddenly put you in the sort of celebrity spotlight?
Oh yeah, I think it did. Yeah, it made a big difference. You know, not. I mean, football's a huge game today, and I mean, it was a big game crowd-wise in those days. But the actual players were not superstars as they make them out to be these days. I mean, you were still feted wherever you went. But I mean, advertising and things like that. I mean, I was quite lucky. I did a bit of advertising, but in those days, it was very few and far between when you found a footballer doing an advert for television or things like that. Whereas now, it's the normal thing. So I spent my whole career at Fulham, 20 years, and a lot of people have always asked me over the years, why did I stay at Fulham? Why didn't I go somewhere else where I could have probably got some medals or something? And in actual fact, the thought never occurred to me, because, I mean, I was a London boy, and Fulham's obviously in London, and I enjoyed playing there. And they paid me good money, and I didn't feel that I could do any better anywhere else. And that's the reason why I stayed at Fulham.